Welcome to CareerPod, your Audible career fair podcast. I'm your host, Dana Francis. Hola! Thank you for joining us this week. We have a really fun episode for you. Today we are going to explore the career path of being a radio show host. I don't think I've ever laughed so much in an interview before. Rachel Day is just one of those dynamic personalities where it's impossible not to be smiling when she's in the room. I just love that I get to meet all these interesting people and share their stories with you. So let's jump straight into this episode. Today we are joined by Rachel Day from 102.3 Now Radio. Of all the occupations out there, radio show host has been at the top of my wish list for a little while now, so I'm so excited to actually have my first pick on the show.
Yeah, that's awesome. Thanks.
I think it's awesome. Like, you've gone on so many mat leaves, and I think a lot of people always kind of worry that when they leave their job and come back again, but you haven't missed a beat. You have a very loyal following from what I can see online, and new moms like me, I look up to people like you, so I'm so excited to have you on the show.
Oh, thanks. I appreciate that. It's funny you mentioned mat leave, because I've been like lately, like, oh, maybe I'll have another baby. Like, I've been like, maybe I'll have one more. And if I mention that on air, because my husband's not for it. He's like, that's enough. We've had enough kids. And if I mention it on air, people will be like, no, you can't go on mat leave again. No, we don't want you to leave. So there, which is very nice for me, but it also backs him in his idea of no more kids. So I'm like, just shh, be quiet. I don't want him to know that. I don't want him to see that.
Oh, that must be really nice, like the work-life balance for the two of you guys, because he works in the morning and you work in the afternoon. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, there's not too many jobs where you get to have that.
It is a dream setup for us. When I first started at this station, the Ginge, that's my husband, his name's Tyler, we call him the Ginge. He's a ginger. And we were just boyfriend and girlfriend. And so when we came here, we've gotten engaged, gotten married, and had three children. And so when I was pregnant with my first, he actually was still working in Red Deer. That's where I came from. And he ended up getting a job here. And they set it up like that so that he would work in the morning. And so that after my mat leave, which was actually only 12 weeks, I could take more. But, you know, in the world of radio, it's kind of, you can take a year, but I didn't want to be away for a year, you know, because it's kind of about building a name. And so I didn't quite feel comfortable being away for a year. So they said, well, what if we set it up so the baby was with your husband? And I was like, well, that sounds great. Because, you know, imagine you're a new mom and at 3 months old, you're trying to send your child to daycare, put them in the care of someone else. You know, I wouldn't have done it. I wouldn't have been able to do it. And so they kind of set it up, and I don't think they ever imagined that I'd just keep having children and
Oh, it worked the first time. Yeah. Let's try again. Yeah, and again. Yeah. And again.
And again. They're like, oh, you're leaving again. That's great. Wonderful. I'm glad we made it so easy for you. But yeah, it's the dream setup. And also, like, when I went on mat leave, I remember thinking, like, I fancied myself. Like, I was like, I'm going to be a stay-at-home mom, and I probably won't ever work again.
And the bills come in.
Yeah, exactly. And I was like, this is not for me. This was not, like, probably about a month in, I was like, all right, maybe I should go back on air. That's about enough for me. I work, let's say I'm out of the house probably for 5 hours a day. And that's it. That includes my travel time. So when I'm gone, it's not a normal full work day. And so it really is just the best setup ever. It makes it very easy to want to go back to work.
I was wondering how that works. Like, what would a day at work look like for you? So do you have any sort of prep work that you have to do before you come into work? Or?
Yeah. So in terms of prep, it's just like stuff that I might want to talk about on the show. But that's kind of, you know, you kind of think of ideas throughout your day. So I always, I have a note in my phone and I always just jot down things. But when I come to work, I usually get in at 2 and then I go down to production first. And that's where I voice commercials. And that's usually just about 10 minutes. And then I go to my desk and I just go online and I see what's happening and I find, you know, different things I could talk about. And then I go on air at 3 and then I'm done at 7.
Sweet. So there's like no post-production I guess you guys don't have post-production.
Yeah. No, there's
sorry.
No, no, once I'm done, I'm done. On the weekends, I do a recorded show, which is called the Voice Track Show, just from 6 to 8 a.m. on Sunday mornings. And so I just use all old phone calls from, like, I have all my calls saved from since I started working here 8 years ago. And so I just go through and find clumps of calls that I want to air. And so I have to record that Friday nights after my show, but it takes me, oh, I don't know, probably 15 minutes to record a 2-hour show.
Oh, nice.
And then on other, like sometimes if people have days off or we have holidays coming up, there'll be extra voice tracking or recording to do, but typically it's my normal. I come in at 2, I leave at 7, and then sometimes there's an extra hour or two here or there. Or events. Sometimes there's events, you know, but those are always fun. It never really feels like work. No, like we've got a karaoke event coming up.
Scaryoke?
Yeah, exactly. Karaoke. That's what it's called. Yeah. And that's like, that's just such a fun night. Actually, my mom's going to come into town. The Ginge and I get to go. It's kind of like a date for us because, you know, we work together and we get to get away without the kids. So we actually kind of enjoy the work events. It's nice.
I really love the radio station because unlike a lot of the other ones in town, you're not going, oh, here's a free trip to Cuba,
yeah,
or a free trip to Paris. It's like, no, we're supporting our local community because you guys have done so many bottle drives. That's actually how I found the studio from before. We've come a few times for the mm-hmm. bottle drive, so mm-hmm. I really like that about this radio station.
Yeah, there have been a lot of, you know, even that bottle drive started out as a very, that was, Fitzy doesn't work here anymore, but he was the one who started it. And that started out as, I'm going to be a little wrong here because I'm not 100% certain, but I know there was a young girl needed some money for something. She had, maybe she needed a van, a special van. I think she was in a wheelchair. And so this family somehow contacted Fitzy and they were needing money for that. And he said, well, why don't we just do like a quick bottle drive? And that was like a 24-hour thing of, you know, if you're driving by the station, throw your bottles down. And they ended up raising like a few $1,000 in a day in like 24 hours. And so then it got bigger and bigger and bigger into those huge bottle drives. And we have a lot of things like that that happen because something will get mentioned on air. And the Now family, that's our listeners, take it to this whole new level where they're bringing money or they're donating time or they're donating services to anyone who they hear might need it. And it's become like this kind of a family helping each other. We say the Now family, which I know sounds so lame, but it's the truth. It's like, the, you know, these people hear about someone in their quote unquote Now family who needs help and they jump to it. And we don't even ask. They just do it. And that's like, that I've never had that at any other radio station ever. It's magic when that happens here.
So what got you into radio? Was there like a passion or a role model growing up that you're like, I want to do that?
No, because I used to listen to the radio all the time. I was like big into radio. I was the person who would like as a teen would call the station for contests. And like, you know, this was back in the day. So I'd dial in on, we had an old like rotary phone. And I'd dial in so that I could set it up and then, you know, do the redial. Oh, no, wait, that must have been on the other phone because the rotary didn't have redial. But I remember dialing in, getting the phone number set up, and then as soon as they'd answer, I'd hang up so that then redial was set. So when they called out for the contest, I could just pick up and hit redial over and over again until I got through. And they hated me. They hated me because it was small town and I was like the only one calling in anyway, but I'd always be calling the phone. So anyway, I was that person. I loved music and I grew up on 90s country. It's my favorite. And I used to like listen to the countdowns and I would write, I would have a notepad and I would write down like number 20 was Garth Brooks that summer. And I had like a weird kind of fascination about it. And then I did a job placement test. Have you ever done that where you answer a bunch of questions and then it says like, you'd be good at being a pharmacist or...
Yeah. In my case, it was completely incorrect. They said I should be a massage therapist.
Well, yeah. It's that. Yeah. And sometimes you're like, no, that's not for me. But I remember radio DJ came up and I literally remember thinking, that's a job? Like those people get paid? I thought it was just like a fun thing. And as soon as I saw that, I was like, well, that's for me. And so that was in grade 9. I just knew then. And I remember, this still like makes me mad. I went to the radio station there. We had to do job shadowing. Mm-hmm. And the guy who was hosting, I can't remember his name. And I was very shy because I was awkward. I was an awkward teenager. I was very nervous and I was very shy. And I remember him trying to get me to talk on air and I was, you know, panicking and everything. And after he turned the mics off, he said to me, well, if you want to be in radio, you're going to have to learn to speak up. up. And he was, and looking back now, it makes me more angry because I'm like, I was a child. I would never speak to a child like that and like ruin their dreams, you know? So I have taken from that as well that I feel like I always want to try and be very encouraging and helpful to anyone who thinks they might want to get into radio instead of, you know, well, if you want to be in radio, you better learn to speak up. Okay, fine.
I went to career fair and I actually had someone tell me that he's like, well, good luck if you want to be a radio host because people don't like to listen to women. This was when I was younger.
What?
And I was like, oh.
Oh, okay.
I was like, you know what? I'm pretty positive you're wrong. And I was like, now I look, you know, forward to... I was like, my favorite radio station, like, I think you guys have gender parity because you have a lot of female hosts and a lot of male hosts, whereas I know with me growing up, it was a male-dominated
field. It was,
field.
Yeah.
But I was like, no, I love listening to, especially the male-female dynamic of a lot of the hosts. It's kind of fun because it's like that bickering couple at the campfire.
Yeah.
I just enjoy listening to it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So education-wise or experience, what if somebody wanted to get into this, what would be the steps that they could take?
Well, traditionally, you go to college or university for radio broadcasting. Nate and Sate both do it. In Lethbridge, I think there's a radio program. I went to a place called Western Academy Broadcasting College in Saskatoon, which is only for broadcasting. It's run by this guy named Don Scott, who's your classic old radio host, and he talks like this, and he teaches you all the special ways to speak, and it's, you know, he, I don't know if he still does, like, 12 years ago when I went to radio school, it was like that, and he would say, make sure that when you're... I remember him teaching, the school was called WABC, so he always said, you never want to have an upward inflection at the end of your word or your phrase. So WABC, he'd say, no, you have to say it WABC. And it was just, for some reason that stuck with me. And that's never something I think about. And that's never something, you know, my coworkers, the radio now is just being yourself. It's just, it should just be whoever you are, just talking and being natural, not thinking about WABC, you know? So. But I went there, and what's really great about him is that he has a lot of connections in radio. And so you don't even have to finish that program. Once you're hired somewhere, then you have a diploma. So, like, I went for a couple months. It's a six-month program. It was when I was there. I don't know what it is now. But I got a job 2 months in, and he was like, all right, you graduated. You know, he sent me off. And so other schools will, like... From my understanding, because I didn't go to them, but, you know, it's a typical college diploma kind of program where you're taking other courses that aren't related to broadcasting, and obviously you have to finish, and you would do an internship with WABC. There was no internship. It was just you got hired and you went off and did your thing. I also know people who got a job just, you know, being who they were, and somebody saw, somebody heard them, like a program director heard them and thought, like, you could, you know, you'd be great on air. And so that's how you get a job. I mean, I would say it's a lot of connections. And it's, if you want, like, let's say you didn't go to school for radio, but you wanted to be in radio, you could get a job on a promo team at a radio station and hustle and do anything they wanted and everything they wanted and work your way up and then ask to record shows. And this station is very accommodating for that. Other stations, I don't know. I can't speak for. So there are many ways to kind of weasel your way in to radio.
I feel like there's people that are just naturally talented in that department. Like, if you go to a party and you see someone and they got 20 people surrounding them listening to a story, that's probably someone that might succeed in this field. And
yeah,
so connections.
Yeah,
you don't have the education.
There's, like, I don't want to say, like, there's no talent needed because, you know, obviously.
I couldn't do it, so.
Yeah, it's, you know, and even those people who are, you know, the life of the party and can gather a crowd, it's a different thing when you are in a room, sometimes with other people, but often by yourself, to be that kind of draw for people when you have nobody interacting with you. You're just doing your own thing. And that really, that comes from... That's experience a lot. You know, you just get used to talking to yourself. And so then you get used to, you know, you're your own crowd. Like, oh, hey. You get used to it.
So salary-wise, like, obviously there's going to be a lot of variation in it because you got your small towns versus your cities. Like, some people in Vancouver are obviously going to be making more than, say, a show here in Edmonton.
Yeah.
But can you give us an idea of range-wise what someone might earn?
It's so varied. When you start out in radio, you will make nothing. And literally nothing sometimes. Sometimes it's an unpaid internship. And so you are literally making nothing. And then you work your way up. When I first started, my very first job in Wainwright, I was doing mornings. This was, let's see, I've been here... This was about 11, 12 years ago. I was making $24,000 a year. And that was my first job. And then you work your way up. Different shows are traditionally mornings pay the most, and drive, which is like your afternoon drive home, will pay the most. And the market that you're in. So I went from Wainwright to Red Deer to Edmonton. And so you move up, the salary moves up as you move up. But it can be anything from, let's say somebody in this city, even people working the same job, it depends on the station. Are you a name in this city? Do people know who you are? Does your name mean anything? Is it worth anything? Is it recognizable? What are your ratings? How well is the station doing? What show are you in? Like, I could say in this city, salaries probably range from... I'm trying to figure out what the lower end would be. Probably $40,000 to $500,000.
I heard that once on one radio show, not on this station, but on another, they were saying, he's like, not to brag, but it's close to what a brain surgeon makes. I'm like, what?
Yeah. Yeah. You can, especially like, do you know who Paul Brown is? Okay, so Paul Brown did the Bear Morning Show for years. Very polarizing guy because he was very crude and, you know, but he had a name in this city. And he left, I don't know, a year ago or so. I would still love to know what that guy was making because he was in this city for years on a very popular morning show. I bet he was close to that. I don't know, anywhere from, well, I would hate to guess what someone else was making, but it would be on that high end. I would love to know.
Can you tell us about some of the things you really love about your job? Like, what makes this the best job ever?
It's just fun. For me, I'm very naturally an introvert. So to sit in a room alone for 4 hours is awesome. I really like that. It's just fun. I enjoy coming to work. There are certainly days where I'm like, if I'm not like feeling on or I'm feeling tired or that, you know, maybe I don't want to go. But I would say that happens a couple times a year. The rest of the time, I'm like, oh, great. I get a little break from my kids. I get to go hang out in the studio. I mean, I love the interaction of people. I love getting to know people. That's something I really like, is I feel like over, you know, almost 8 years at this station, I've had a lot of people that have been listening since even before I was here. And, you know, they heard me on my very first day. And so they've known me from when the Ging and I were boyfriend and girlfriend to now married. And now we have three kids. And I know them, too. I know about their jobs. I know about their kids. I know where they work. I know like what typical times when they would call. And I like that kind of...
And I'm not a stalker.
Yeah, exactly. I liked it, like that kind of connection. You know, like it really... You really feel like you're building a connection with people. And I really like that. And the people I work with are awesome. We really have a lot of fun. And it's a fun building and it's a fun atmosphere. And it's just fun.
What kind of challenges do you run into? Like, what would be something, if someone wasn't talented in a certain department, would you try to like steer them away from this profession?
You have to learn how to let things go. Because there will be people who... you know, will text you something mean or will, you suck or this sucks or whatever. And you just have to learn to, whatever, you can't get hung up on it. Because it's that thing of where there's one person telling you you're terrible, but you'll have had, say, like 30 other texts that day of like, I love the show and I love this. But you know, your brain fixes on the one.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have to be able to let that go. But it's difficult because when you are... especially for this radio station, because I'm just me on the air. I'm not, you know, just reading about a cool vacation that we're giving away. And, you know, so when someone says something mean to me, like, that's saying something mean to me. That's not just, like, my fake personality of who I am on air, you know? And so that's what I would say. other than that, like, there aren't really a ton of challenges. Well, people get fired in radio. That's another thing. It's very common. It just happened in the city. Three hosts got laid off. Or not laid off. They were fired at another station. I don't know why. Often it's because maybe the ratings weren't that great. And so they bring in someone new. And that, I mean, that's hard to get fired, you know? I think most people who've been in radio for a long enough time, they've been fired at some point. It's just kind of how it works. Or a station changes formats. So maybe the station isn't doing well. And then they'll reformat to, like, they went from a country station to a rock station. And all of a sudden, all those hosts that you had on that station aren't suitable for the new format. And so everybody gets laid off. And it's kind of the business.
That's kind of everything right now. That's
well, there you
why
go.
Why I started the show, because I was like, everybody has to have that plan B, because right? we're not in the time where my parents grew up and they had the same careers their entire life. That is not my generation. That is not millennials. That won't be Gen Zs.
That's exactly it. You have to, yeah, I would say if you want to get into radio, have like another plan. Like just
just have like two or three maybe.
Well, and that's the thing too. A lot of people who go to school for radio find out that they'll think they want to be on air, but then they'll end up in production or they'll end up doing something else in radio. Or I can't tell you how many people leave. They do radio for a couple months or a year, or they don't even start. And they're like, nope, it's not for me. Because it is, being on air can be a bit harder than I think. People always say, oh, it would be so easy. I think it would be easy to, I think I could do that. People always say that. I think I could do that. But then you bring someone like that in and put them in front of a mic, and it's a lot harder than you imagine. They'd get it if, you know, they had a couple years to practice it, like the rest of us have, because, you know, I would hate to hear some of my first shows. Oh, God. That must have been really bad.
That's the importance, too, of job shadowing before you pursue something. And that's something I really encourage on the show. Job shadowing and volunteer work. Because if you want to do something, get an idea for what that environment is like. Because I know I volunteered at a hospital when I was younger. And that shut the door for nursing on me so fast. Because I was like, nothing but respect for the people that do it for a living. But... not for me.
Yeah, that's exactly it. Come into a radio station, ask to job shadow, ask to intern, ask to work on a summer promo team, and you'll get a good idea of what it's like. And then, you know, then you don't have to invest money in college for it and decide, oh, well, I guess I'm not going to do that now.
And a good way to make those connections, too, because obviously if you get along with the people at that station, who knows, maybe there's no jobs then, but there might be sometime in the future. Is there much competition for work? Like, I know media is changing all the time. I mean, now we have YouTube and we have all sorts of things on the internet and we have podcasting, which is just recently started kind of booming. So where do you think the radio industry is going for the future if you had like a little glass ball?
People will say that radio is dying. Well, that was a thing when satellite radio came out. It was like, oh, well, terrestrial radio, it's dead and it's never going to... It didn't affect us at all. I don't think radio is going anywhere, because we live in a world where there are podcasts available. There is satellite radio. You can have your music on streaming from the music you want to listen to from your phone, from your iPod, into your car, and you can listen to whatever you want to. And still, hundreds of thousands of people choose to listen to radio. And
it's free.
Because it's free, and there's that connection, and that's something, you know, sure, you can listen to whatever music you want to listen to, but there's nobody talking to you. There's no connection. And while sometimes you don't want people talking to you, and that's great. But when you do, you know, that's where radio is. I personally don't think it's going anywhere. I hope it doesn't go anywhere. But it is competitive, because think about carpentry jobs in the city or construction jobs. You know, how many do you think are available? Thousands, right? There are maybe, I would hate to throw a number out. Let's just say hosts of shows on a typical radio station. I don't know, maybe 100 in the city. Not even, you know, and so, but there's still a lot of people trying to get those jobs. And so, yeah, it is competitive. And there's always someone who's looking to take your job. And there is always someone who would love to weasel their way in there. And there are a lot of people like that in this business who are weaseling and looking for opportunities and are a little bit sketchy and a little questionable.
That's why I love this community, because with podcasting, we're just so supportive of one another, because we're just little beans, so we're all trying to help each other grow, and it's such a wonderful community.
Yeah, I've heard of some nasty exchanges between, people talking about other radio stations, and I don't know, a lot of my coworkers know other radio hosts in the city, because they've worked with them. I don't know anyone. I know who the people who work here, and actually my very first program director who hired me works over at Fresh. He's not on air. Sometimes he hosts on air. But other than that, I don't know anyone in this city. So I just hear about it, of kind of like the nasty talk, and I'm like, oh, that's not. I'll just stay home, I think. I won't go to I won't go out and mingle.
I'm happy with my kids.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they kind of take over your life.
Oh, yeah. 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 The kids for sure. Yeah. But that's where we're so lucky here. Like, I've brought my kids to work a lot. My daughter sat in the studio with me for some days. She just likes to come to work, and people are bringing out crayons and we're coloring, and it's like they're excited when kids show up. They're like, yay!
That's so awesome.
Yeah, it's great.
So is this what you wanted to be? Like, you said grade 9.
Yeah.
This was kind of... Was this what you always wanted to be? Was there any other professions you could think of from when you were younger?
Well, I wanted to be a vet, like every young girl did. Everyone wanted to be a vet, a marine biologist. So yes, I went down that road. I thought about that. I remember saying I wanted to be a baby doctor, but that's that's not for me. Although, I would. That's kind of my plan B, is to be a doula or a midwife. If this doesn't work out, or I change my mind eventually, that's something for me. So maybe I would. Not a doctor, but a midwife or a doula. And I did, after I graduated, and I was like, do I want to go to school to do radio? I don't know. Maybe I'll just do something a bit more stable and safe. I was going to do early childhood development and be a preschool teacher. And that's also something that's still kind of on my mind. I feel like I love going to my kids' classrooms. I love that environment of just those little snot machines, and they're all, they're just
all
so
germs.
Yeah, I love it. I love the singing the songs and doing the crafts, and so that was kind of on my mind. But it really was always radio for me. Yeah.
Say you're at one of your kids' graduation, and they want you to speak for the graduating class.
Oh, God.
What would be your sunscreen song?
Oh, what would be? Oh, man.
You have like a symphony playing in the background.
Yeah.
People are like, what's the sunscreen song? Just Google it.
Google it. You got to Google it. It's really good. It's by Boz Luhrmann, for those of you that don't know. Oh, it's so tough. It's so tough because I don't find myself to be like a motivation. I never feel like I have like wonderful words of wisdom for people. For me, okay, so it's at grad, so they're like 17, right? They're not like awkward 15-year-old, a little older.
What do you know now as an adult that you wish you knew back when you were younger? That advice that older people give to you, and you're like, oh, yeah, and you don't listen to it, and then you turn 30, and you're like, oh,
right.
That was such good advice.
Well, that's the thing. That's, that thing, youth is wasted on the young. That's where I feel like we need to quit giving advice to younger people, because they're not going to hear it. Get them to come and ask you when they're 30, and then they'll take your good advice. But I don't know. I guess it's for me, like, what would I want for my own kids, for them to feel? I would say find something that you love. Whatever that is, find what you love and do that. Because then, that's such a hard thing to say, because especially in this economy where people are, maybe they're getting fired from doing the things they love. And so they have to take a job they don't love to pay the bills. But if it's possible for you, find something that you love and do that. And because even when you're not making, like, let's say you're not making a ton of money. Like, when I was only making $24,000 a year, I loved what I was doing. And so I didn't, I've never much cared about, well, I shouldn't say that. I obviously care about
making an extra zero behind things.
It's nice when you start making more money. But, I would do this job for $40,000 a year, because I love it. And that's nice to know. So when you, if you get fired and you have to take a smaller job, then that's okay. Like, I would still love it, I would still, so I would say that. Find whatever you love and try and make money at that. And even if it's not much money, that's okay, because you'll love it.
If there was to be three tips you would give to someone considering this career profession, what would those top things be for you?
Well, I like what you said about job shadowing. I think that would be a really great start. I would say, I feel like just seeing younger people come into this business, I feel like sometimes they expect too much too soon. And they think, you know, well, I can be hosting a morning show in Edmonton, or why should I have to go work in a small town? Well, you do, because that's where you learn, you know, that's where you're building your radio skill and learning how to be comfortable on air is in that small crap town where you're making, you know, no money and you're away from your family. And I would say you need to be prepared to do that. You need to be prepared to work for free. You need to be prepared to ask to be asked to do all the crap stuff around the station that nobody else wants to do. And maybe you're running around the city picking up decorations for a stupid Halloween thing that the station is doing. And that might be your thing you have to do, you know?
Delivering popsicles.
Exactly. You're wearing a popsicle milkman outfit and you're driving around the city handing out popsicles. You know, be prepared to do that stuff. Because I feel like a lot of, I see a lot of people, younger people who come into this business who expect too much too fast. And then they get jaded very quickly because they expect, well, why can't I just work in Edmonton? Or why aren't I getting hired here for this shift? Well, it's, you know, frankly, it's because you're not good enough. And you will be, but you got to go work in this small town. And that's another thing. You got to be willing to move around. That's something you have to know. You know, it is very unlikely that, I mean, I've seen it happen. I've seen people get, say, an overnight job here in the city, in Edmonton. That's where they started. And then they slowly work their way up through the day parts. And, you know, maybe eventually they do mornings or they do drive or they're doing middays. But that's very rare. Mm-hmm. Usually, you know, you're moving from town to town to town. You're probably moving once a year. You're moving. So that's something you have to be prepared to do.
Some people look forward to that, though. Like, I traveled a lot when I was younger, and I was like, I loved it. Living in other places and experiencing new atmospheres.
Yeah, but where did you travel to? Like, where did you say you went?
New Zealand?
Yeah. So
Central
like
Central America.
Yeah, like cool places. I'm talking about like you're gonna live in Wainwright. You know, then maybe if you're lucky you'll go to Medicine Hat and you know. But yeah, some people don't mind that touring around. And there will be a lot of rejection too. It's sort of and you don't need to feel bad about that. Sometimes you're just not what a station's looking for. You're not for everyone. Oh, that's something I'd say to people who are graduating. You're not for everyone, and that's okay. Mm-hmm. Not everyone is going to like you. You don't like everyone. Just because somebody doesn't see your value or see how, you know, doesn't think you're something doesn't mean 500 other people don't see that in you. So that's something too. You gotta get used to rejection and know that you'll get there. You'll get there eventually.
Well, thank you so much for coming on the show. So much awesome information for, and I know there's a lot of people that this is kind of like on their wished list of careers, not just.
Yeah, it is. It's a dream job. It really, and it is. Like for me, I'm doing it. It's a dream job, guys. Like it's as great as you think it is. It really is.
I know not everyone is lucky enough to be living in the great city of Edmonton. So if you're not local to the area, Now Radio has an app where you can listen to them online. I will be including the link along with their social media handles in our show notes. And full disclosure, I'm not advertising for them. I'm just genuinely a grateful, loyal listener. If you were to jump into my car, you'd know that's the truth. Next on the show, we have Andrea Bessa, videographer, storyteller, and podcast host to That's So Maven. I am super excited because this interview was actually supposed to happen last month. But no thanks to tomato soup of all things, I was down for the count with food poisoning. Andrea was gracious enough to reschedule, which I am so grateful for because I know as an entrepreneur, she doesn't have a lot of spare time. And also a big thank you to James at Two Bodies of Water for understanding and rebooking our studio time. I can't say enough good things about the people in our podcasting community. They are so generous with their time. If you're enjoying the show, feel free to drop us a review. And if you'd like to make any suggestions for future shows, you can find us on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. Just search CareerPod. Thank you so much for joining us today. Till we meet again, stay passionately curious.